We are glad you can join us today for the ECG 2023 Physician and APP Compensation Survey Key Findings, Compensation Production and Benefit Trends webcast. My name is Angie Collins, a manager at ECG, and I'm pleased to be your moderator for today's program. In this webinar, ECG's team of experts will review findings of ECG's 24th Annual Physician and APP Compensation Survey, as well as provide guidance on preparing for 2024. The session will include our analysis of important physician and advanced practice provider performance trends from the 2023 survey and provide recommendations from our experts on what organizations should implement now and in 2024 to address the 2024 Medicare Physician Fee Schedule updates, trends in value-based care and compensation planning, as well as recent regulatory changes. Before we begin the formal program, let's go over a few details about the webinar. Today's program will be 60 minutes in length, which will include 55 minutes of presentation. Everyone should have received a copy of the session handouts, but if you were a late registrant, you can download the handout in the handout pane on your screen. Attendees are participating in listen-only mode, but if you have questions, you can type them into the questions pane on the screen at any time, and we will address them after the webinar in an FAQ sent by email. We'll be launching a few audience polling questions today, and we hope that you will participate in this interactive measurement tool. And finally, upon exiting today's program, you will be directed to an electronic survey. Your feedback is very important to us, so please take a minute to complete this survey. For each completed survey, ECG will make a $5 donation to Doctors Without Borders. Now let's meet today's speakers. Maria Hayduk is an associate principal with ECG. She has extensive experience in medical group and provider market surveys and benchmark development, provider compensation planning, medical practice and organizational performance improvement, and academic medicine. At ECG, Maria leads the provider analytics practice, including the production of the firm's national physician, faculty, APP, and medical group performance studies. For over 20 years, Maria has overseen the conduct and expansion of ECG's adult and pediatric subspecialty physician, faculty, and APP compensation and production surveys, and she's played an integral role in launching and expanding the firm's medical group performance survey for large integrated healthcare organizations. Welcome, Maria.
Thanks, Angie. Great to be here.
Also speaking today is Aurora Young. Aurora is a partner with ECG and a nationally recognized expert in provider total compensation, with more than 20 years of healthcare consulting experience. As a leader in ECG's valuation services practice, she has extensive knowledge from navigating legal and regulatory requirements and working across healthcare organizations and specialties to determine compensation arrangements that meet fair market value and commercial reasonableness guidelines. Aurora also works with healthcare organizations in the design, implementation, and administration of physician and advanced practice provider compensation strategies. Welcome, Aurora.
Thank you, Angie. I'm looking forward to today's discussion.
Wonderful. So we are going to jump over to the agenda review today. We are going to spend just a moment or two talking through ECG for those who may be a little less familiar with our firm. Going to then ask Maria to speak to the key findings from our 2023 Physician and APP Compensation Survey. And then we'll get into some market trends specifically around hospital-based specialties. And we'll wrap up today's program with a brief discussion about our ECG Compensation Survey member benefits. I'm going to now turn it over to provide an overview of the survey to Maria.
Thank you, Angie. So this is Aurora. Just quickly want to spend a few minutes giving you an overview of ECG. Many of you probably have a deep understanding of who we are, but others may not. So ECG is actually celebrating its 50th anniversary this year. We have been, over the course of our history, spending a national consulting firm dedicated to providing healthcare consulting services. You can see we have almost 250 consultants that work nationwide from Hawaii to New York to Florida and everywhere in between, providing consulting services to our clients around strategy, finance, operations, and technology. As you can see on the next slide, we have the full continuum of healthcare represented within our clients. We work with some of the nation's largest health systems, rural health centers, federally qualified health centers, as well as prestigious children's hospitals and academic medical centers. And we work with physicians, advanced practice providers, payers, and ASCs. So there's really no kind of area of healthcare that we don't touch in terms of the consulting services that we can provide. On the next slide, you can see a little bit more about kind of our deep expertise in some of the key areas of services. We've got individuals who working across the continuum of academic healthcare. In fact, ECG's roots are really founded in our academic healthcare practice. We have individuals in performance transformation, really digging into the operations and how organizations can transform the performance of their organization. Our managed care services division is looking at managed care contracting and reimbursement for our clients and really helping to improve and also look at those value-based contracting reimbursement opportunities within the organization. Our strategy and business advisory group is really deep in physician and service line strategy, and not last, but provider financial services. So that's the group that Maria and Angie and I are represented within, provide the full continuum of financial services, including compensation, cash compensation design, valuation, as well as business and enterprise valuation services, provider analytics and surveys, and compensation administration and implementation guidance. So on slide 9, you can see just a little bit more about our compensation expertise. As I mentioned, we work across a continuum of healthcare organizations. You can see represented just a sample of our clients on this slide. At any given time, our dedicated group of consultants, we're about 50 consultants who deal in provider compensation issues, are working across various enterprise-wide compensation planning engagements, handling compensation design, valuation, the full continuum of compensation and business enterprise support for our clients. So with that, I will turn it over to Maria and let her take you through the findings from our survey.
Thank you, Aurora. So I'm excited to be here today to present a few of the high-level findings from our 2023 Physician and APP Compensation Survey. But this year was our largest survey to date. We have 130,000 providers in our final data set, and those providers are across several of the surveys that we do on an annual basis, including our pediatric subspecialty and physician and APP compensation survey that we recently completed. We just did our 17th year and actually presented our high-level findings for that yesterday. And if any of you are interested in seeing that presentation or discussing those findings, please reach out to me and Angie, and we'll be happy to have those discussions. We also just completed our largest faculty physician survey. It was our fifth annual, and our largest APP performance survey that also completed in the same timeline. We do several other surveys as well. We do market, hot topic trend studies, rapid surveys. We partner with associations and societies to kind of review the market in terms of trends in their specialty space. We also have a medical group cost and staffing study where we partner with large medical groups affiliated with health systems to develop service line specific cost and FTE benchmarks at the service line level. But one last thing I'd like to highlight before we get into some of the findings is we do have a CPT profiler, which is our tool that we offer our survey members the ability to profile their providers at the specialty level based on the CPT data that we collect in our annual compensation surveys. And finally, I want to mention ECG Vault, which is our online data portal that's available to all of our survey members. Each of you should have received or have a personal login credentials to get access to our findings and all of our collateral material, all of the Excel files, reports that we publish with respect to our surveys. And those credentials will allow you to download those materials and get access to documents such as this one and our final reports. If you do not have your credentials or would like to schedule a training session with us, please reach out to us after the session and we will make sure to get you those. So moving on to slide 12, the next two slides really provide you with a high level demographics for our 2023 surveys. This year, we had great geographic representation in both of our adult and pediatric provider compensation surveys. We're very purposeful in trying to expand some of the regions of where we have providers represented. And this year, we had 48 states represented, as well as the District of Columbia, with balanced geographic representation. The largest region remains the Western region with 32% of the providers practicing in that region, 28% in the Midwest, 21% in the East, and 19% in the Southern region. On slide 13, the figures from this point forward are going to be focused specifically on the adult subspecialties, so physician and APP compensation survey. So just focus, not including the pediatric subspecialist positions, which included in this year nearly 19,000 providers in that study. So this slide speaks to who is employing the providers in our adult survey. Most of the providers in our final data set are affiliated with integrated health systems and academic institutions. But we do have nearly 5% of the providers who are in the final data set that are affiliated with private equity organizations, independent medical groups, and other types of provider organizations that are not the traditional, you know, academic or integrated health system or community hospital. Also, the providers in our data set are primarily working in large medical groups, with 84% of the providers working in groups with more than 500 physicians. And that's up from 79% last year as organizations consolidate and acquisitions and grow their medical groups. Only 3% of the providers in our final data set work within organizations that employ fewer than 150 providers. So as you're referencing benchmarks for compensation planning purposes, it's important to understand who's in the benchmark. We do provide flexibility and keep the power to cut our data via a variety of different cuts in terms of by group size, by ownership, by provider tenure, by location. All of those capabilities are available in our ECG Vault dynamic report, as well as we present those cuts in our tables and Excel files that you're able to download via ECG Vault. So on slide 13, before I get into some of the high level key trends, or on the next slide, on the slide 14, there are a couple of market factors that persist today that we're all aware of that have impacted not only this year's benchmarks, but prior year benchmarks as well. And I want to make sure that we keep those things in mind as we go through the findings. First and foremost, this is our 2023 report, but it represents fiscal year 2022 activity. So every organization provided us their most recent fiscal year data. In most cases, it was calendar year 2022 data. So we're looking backwards in time. And it also represents a snapshot of data for those organizations. many of the same factors that also impacted our last year's survey and the year before persist today in a what I'm calling a post-COVID world. And you know, many of you are having your own experiences in terms of how patients have returned to medical to visit your providers, and some have returned back to full, you know, capacity. Others still are lagging behind. But there's some other trends that are important to point out, including that are impacting medical group practice, including issues experienced with labor shortages. Right, we have provider burnout and some mental health challenges that we're dealing with. Staffing levels by health industry sector indicate that staffing for physician offices has largely returned to pre-COVID levels, but staffing in other healthcare sites, including acute care, nursing, home health, and even some outpatient clinics, are below pre-COVID levels that are going to impact our trend because providers are not able to generate the same level of production if there's some acute care staffing shortages, for instance. And beyond those trends that are impacting performance, we have the we still are seeing the remnants of the implementation of CMS's 2021 Medicare physician fee schedule, which included the most significant changes to E&M RVU values that we've seen since 2007. And the downstream impact of those changes by CMS to medical group revenue, provider comp plans, production, and benchmarks that are being reported out in this year's survey and last year's survey have been, you know, significant and are sometimes confusing and hard to interpret. As a reminder, ECG's RVU benchmarks are 100% calculated by us and from CPT code provider level billing data that you guys supply us with. And so we can control for a change in the Medicare physician fee schedule and report out not only standard benchmarks, but supplemental benchmarks. On slide 15, I'll walk through a little bit about what those supplemental benchmarks are. We publish standard benchmarks in 2023. We have over 30 specialty specific metrics. Some of those are highlighted on the bottom right of the slide, including RVU and RVU rates calculated by ECG using the 2022 Medicare physician fee schedule applied to survey member provider level CPT code billing data. But in addition to those standard unadjusted benchmarks, we published two supplemental data sets of RVU and RVU ratios by specialty. The first is our 2023 RVU benchmarks calculated using the 2020 Medicare physician fee schedule. And the second is our 2023 RVU benchmarks calculated using the 2023 Medicare physician fee schedule applied to provider level CPT code data. And we've also analyzed the impact on our benchmarks of the various CMS fee schedules, the 2020, 2022, 2023, and also the 2024 Medicare physician fee schedule, which I'll highlight on a later slide. So on slide 16, let's get into the actual trends. So I'm going to really focus on the chart on the right, or the table on the right side of the slide. I'm showing three summary trends for in aggregate for physicians only. And this is for all of the physicians in our final data set. We're looking at the 2023 results compared to other data sets and what that information is showing us. So the first column is the 2023 standard results compared to 2022. The second column is the 2023 standard results compared to 2022, recalculated under the 2022 Medicare physician fee schedule. And then finally, we are looking at the 2023 survey results compared to 2020 survey results, restated under the 2022 Medicare physician fee schedule. And this is really to give us some sense of where are we compared to pre-COVID. Where before medical practice was disrupted. So what we see in the first column is that compensation in aggregate across all physician specialties increased by 5.1% over 2022. Work RVUs increased by 5.7% and net professional collections have increased by 7%. In the second column, when we restate last year's results using the 2022 Medicare physician fee schedule, we do not see any measurable impact to the change in medians by utilizing the newer fee schedule. However, in the last column, when we compare this year's results to our 2020 pre-pandemic survey, and this is the most interesting column in my mind, when we recalculate the 2020 results using the same basis, we are seeing compensation in our this year's results is 3.7% higher than before COVID, but our work RVUs remain 2.5% below pre-COVID levels. And net professional collections, however, are nearly 9% higher, not unexpected given the release of the CMS Medicare Physician Fee Schedule that weighted E&M RVUs so much higher. So as a result, compensation per work RVU medians are almost 10% higher now than what they were before the health emergency. But compensation as a percentage of net professional collections is lower by 2.6%. So in aggregate, these trends, we wanted to take a look, take a deeper look by specialty category to see whether there was any other findings that we could derive by specialty category. So looking on slide 17, we've split up the first and third column by specialty category here. And as we look at these, in the first table, we show the 2023 results compared to the 2022 results, while the bottom table is looking at 2023 compared to 2020 restated. In the top table, we see that compensation, in fact, did increase across all specialty categories, with primary care seeing the biggest increase of 6.3%. Similarly, work RVU medians also increased across each specialty category. But since work RVU gains outweighed compensation gains for all except primary care, compensation per work RVU medians are actually down in this year's survey compared to last year's survey. And this was not unexpected by those in the industry and by us who knew that last year's production was still below 2020. We expected production to increase by a faster pace this year, but as such, the larger production gains has resulted in those rates going down because they outpace, in many cases, the compensation increases. But for primary care, compensation still did outpace work RVU gains, which has resulted in a net 1.3% increase in compensation per work RVU medians over what we were seeing in 2022. In the bottom table, when we compare earnings and production to pre-COVID 2020 results restated using the newer fee schedule, we see the compensation is higher across each of the specialty categories, but production remains below the 2020 survey levels. So in aggregate, compensation per work RV medians that are being paid out right now are almost 10% higher than before the health emergency, 9.8% in aggregate higher than before COVID hit. So moving on to slide 17, or 18, my apologies. I don't want to spend a lot of time on this slide, but just to emphasize, these are what I'm showing here are the 2023 results restated using different Medicare physician fee schedules. So it's all the same provider data, all the same providers. We've just recalculated the RVUs in the first column on the left using the 2020 Medicare physician fee schedule. The second column is the 2022 fee schedule, and the third column is the 2023 fee schedule. We've also done the same thing where we've calculated the compensation per work RVU using the different fee schedules. And as you can see here, depending on how those RVUs are calculated, there's some major differences, particularly in the specialties that are heavily using evaluation and management CPT codes. If we focus for a moment just on the medicine and the primary care subcategory, specialty categories, you can see that our work RVU medians in 2023, when we calculate that using the 2022 fee schedule, the median is 5904. But when we restate it using 2020, it's 5,025. That's almost a 20% difference. Similarly, for medicine, it goes from 5589 up to 6337. So depending on how you're calculating your individual provider's RVUs for inclusion in your compensation plans, it's just important to understand how the RVUs are calculated within the survey benchmarks that you're referencing. When you're blending survey benchmarks across multiple surveys, it's important to make sure that you're using benchmarks that have been calculated similarly. There's a similar impact to the compensation per work RVU, as you might imagine. If we just focus on primary care, for instance, this year's standard benchmark for primary care, the median, aggregate median, is $49.98. When we recalculate that using the earlier fee schedule, that median is $59.12. So you can understand if you're calculating RVUs using one or other schedule and use the wrong rate, there's a big potential to have unintended consequences in terms of payouts to your providers, either underpaying or overpaying. So with that, I'm going to turn the program back over to Angie for our first two polling questions.
Wonderful. Thank you so much, Maria. So polling question number one is up on your screen now, and it reads, which Medicare physician fee schedule are you using in 2023 to calculate work RVUs within your physician incentive plan? Please select one of the following: 2020 or earlier, 2021, 2022, 2023, or I don't know. So I think that this question is going to be very interesting with the results with where we're at here at the end of 2023. This is actually a data point that ECG has tracked for 2 years now. I believe we did our first rapid survey of healthcare organizations across the country in late 2021, and then we did another one in 2022. So I'll be very interested to track the kind of movement and see where our group is at. So with that, I think I will close the survey. Okay, very interesting. So what we have here is that 23% of our participants on the line responded that you are still on the 2020 or earlier fee schedule. 3% are on the 2021 schedule, 6% on the 2022 schedule, and the majority at 57% on the 2023 schedule, and then 11% of individuals said that they were unsure and did not know. So thank you everyone for participating. Maria, any thoughts on those results before we launch the next poll?
No, Aurora and I were just talking about this, that our experience is that we are seeing between a quarter and 30% of our clients still referencing the 2020 fee schedule. Aurora, any thoughts on these findings?
No, yeah, it's consistent with our clients. What I'll be curious, you know, is to hear of these organizations, do we see organizations in 2024 moving to the now current fee schedule if they've been through that planning process? But it doesn't surprise me based on client experience, knowing that that there were a number of clients that did decide to delay implementation of the updated fee schedule in their provider compensation plans just due to some of the challenges with the market data, the challenges with the timing of transition and communication, and just kind of wanting to have some time to allow for the physician fee schedule changes to kind of bear out.
Wonderful. So the second poll is, appearing on your screen now, and it is very similar. Which Medicare physician fee schedule is your organization planning on using in 2024? And this time your options are the 2022 schedule or earlier, somewhere between the 2021 and 2023 schedules, 2024, or I don't know. And I think going along with Aurora's comments, I'll be particularly interested to look at that 2020 or earlier bucket. In particular, after 2021 schedule reflected the largest changes that we had seen in over a decade from CMS, 2022 and 23 were fairly benign. We did have a bump in some inpatient E&Ms. And then 2024 is very neutral to 2023. Maria will discuss a little bit about the impact of that in a few minutes, but there's very little change in the 2024 fee schedule that we're projecting as well. So I wonder if organizations will feel like the changes have subsided enough that they can begin to take on some of those planning processes. So I think we'll go ahead and close this poll and show these results. Okay, so we do see some movement. I believe that that figure was 27% in the earlier poll? And so now heading into 2024, we have a minority of our participants saying they intend to be on the 2020 or earlier fee schedule. And those individuals have now bumped over to at least the 2021 schedule, 2022 and three, making up 24% of the responses. But again, over half of you said you'll be on the 2024 schedule at 54%, and 14% were not sure under the I don't know. Any additional thoughts on kind of that transition and how those numbers change and flex from the current state to this upcoming year?
Well, I think it's good news for our membership, right? Because I think that everyone has been struggling on interpreting survey data. And so the further out we can get from the implementation of the 2021 schedule is, you know, obviously going to clear up some of the benchmarks, because even that the 2024 results are going to be impacted by that one quarter of organizations who are still on 2020 when they report next year's data. But beyond next year, it should begin to stabilize, I imagine. Aurora?
Yeah, I would agree. I mean, I think the big question mark is the split shared billing changes. And I know they've been delayed, at least in the proposed schedule, but that will be kind of the longer term question mark, I think, for a lot of organizations. So Maria, with that, I'd love to kind of hear your thoughts on the MPFS changes and the potential impact of 2024.
Excellent. Well, let's get into it. All right, so Angie mentioned the 2024 Medicare physician fee schedule, and it hasn't been completely released yet, but there was a preliminary 2024 Medicare physician fee schedule that was released on July 13th. And within that release, CMS had made some proposals regarding the 2024 plan, including some key provisions outlined on this slide. And they include a delay in the implementation of the change to the definition of what constitutes the substantive portion for split share visits in the facility setting. And Aurora is going to talk a little bit about those split share, that split share change later in the presentation, but it can have some downstream impact and operational impact that to inpatient care models, comp design that she'll speak to a bit more. But there's also another big change in the proposal by CMS, and that includes the reintroduction of this G2211 CPT code with an RVU value of 0.33. And it is, and Medicare intends for every each outpatient E&M code to be billed with this G2211 CPT code. And they believe that it will reflect, or they're trying to value, primary care and longitudinal care for complex patients with the addition of that that new G code. But while it's not as significant change as we saw in 2021, it actually will move our medians a bit depending on the adoption of that code. So Medicare has given us some guidance in with respect to how they believe it will impact physician performance or physician production. And so we have taken those numbers and run it through our 2023 results and said, okay, so what would happen with our medians if this code existed last year, and if the adoption rate is as Medicare expects. So they have reported that they believe their partial adoption of the code would mean that 38% of E&M codes will be billed with this new G code, and full implementation would mean that 54% of the E&M codes will be billed with this new G code. So if there is no G code, as Angie mentioned before, we would not likely see any measurable movement in the median, assuming the same level of production and CPT code service mix. Partial adoption, our medians for medicine and primary care in particular, would move, increasing by between 2.8 and 4.3%, and still measurable impact to the surgeons, with a 1.8% change in medians under partial adoption of the G code. And then under full adoption, again, where they are predicting 54% of the E&M code being billed with this additional 0.33 work RVU value, medians for primary care would go up by over 6%, and medicine medians could go up by 4%. The interesting part about this is, unfortunately, organizations would not, we're not projecting them to receive a corresponding increase in revenue because of the proposed conversion factor reduction from $32 and, they're proposing a conversion factor of $32.75, which is a decrease of $1.14, roughly 3.3% decrease from the current conversion factor of $33.90. So if you look at the specialty categories that don't use a lot of E&Ms, there's a concern there, because if they're not getting any increased production as this as a result of this G code, but they are getting a lower conversion factor payment rate from Medicare and potentially others, there could actually be a decrease in revenue across those specialty categories. On the slide 21, I want to just highlight a phenomenon just to make sure that everyone understands that when we're publishing survey rates and benchmark medians, that they represent aggregate rates, right? We're putting all of the physicians who are paid under different methodologies, under different with different payment rates, into a bucket and calculating quartiles. So in order to illustrate how physicians who are producing at different rates actually differ from the median rates, we've taken our physicians within these specialty categories who are producing between the median and the 75th percentile in terms of work RVUs, and compared their compensation per work RVU rate medians to the overall median. And you can see across the board, those higher producers are actually earning or having a lower compensation per work RVU medians than the overall market by, on aggregate, 7.1%. It's even more drastic when we look at the 75th percentile. I mean, that can be different by, you know, roughly 30% from the overall market from these higher producing physicians. And so it's just important to keep that in mind when you're looking at survey data, that it is a representative of a whole host of different providers, some on straight salaries, some on production models, some who have higher complement of value-based incentives, and to use it as a reference and as a guide in setting rates within your own comp plan. On slide 22, you know, we do collect non-production-based incentives for our providers as well as at the organization level. And then we're seeing higher complement of non-production incentives in the in our comp plans. And looking at the panel size on the left side, we're seeing a decrease in the adjusted panel size. And this might relate a little bit to what Aurora is going to mention later with a downward pressure on our full-time expectations for hospital-based physicians. But when we look at the comparison of panel size just for the same organizations that were in this year's survey to last year's survey, it still goes down, but not as drastic. Similarly, we have a provider level value-based earnings by provider, including quality and patient satisfaction compensation. And you can see across the board, those as a complement of total compensation has increased to 7.6% of total compensation this year. Primary care for the first time, we're seeing in double digits, 10.2% of compensation related to these measures. As a result, the compensation for these measures is ranging across the board between $27,000 and $37,000 per physician FTE. On slide 23, I want to touch upon benefits quickly. Just to point out that physician benefits, we're not seeing a big trend. They're roughly $50,000 per physician FTE, but as a percentage of compensation, it's gone down. That's simply because compensation has gone up. However, with our APPs, compensation benefits has gone up to $31,400, and as a proportion of compensation, it's gone up as well to 24.3%. On slide 24, just want to highlight that we do have deep data on APPs. We have APP earnings and production data, as well as value-based metrics by provider type, as well as by specialty. In aggregate, we see trends that are similar to some of our primary care physicians, but even more drastic with nurse practitioners, seeing an increase in compensation of 5.5%, non-surgical PAs going up nearly 6%, and surgical PAs, which we've heard from a lot of our clients, there's upward pressure on surgical PA compensation of 9%. And so before I turn it over, Aurora, did you have any thoughts on the APP compensation trends that we're seeing with specific specialties?
Yeah, so I would just highlight again, what you're seeing here is generally kind of some national trends, particularly with the worker review medians. I think it's really important to note, you know, there's a lot of movement and kind of evolution of advanced practice provider compensation models, taking into account things like specialty, scope of practice setting, in terms of how organizations are thinking about the structure of their APP compensation model, and also how they're setting compensation levels. Particularly as we also are seeing, very hard to recruit positions in certain specialty areas. You can see here cardiovascular surgery is a great example of that, where there's considerable market pressure, behavioral health, other specialty areas where we are starting to see kind of premiums or, kind of increased pressure in the compensation relative to other specialty areas. Again, as I mentioned, the compensation model structure will really help to kind of understand also what the earning potential is. The adoption of production-based plans in outpatient specialty practices, urgent care practices is starting to really grow in prevalence, and we're starting to see increased compensation levels that are more and more tied to the performance of the APPs. Although those plans are not like their physician counterparts, and typically not peer production, again, we are starting to see more incorporation. And so as you look at the worker view medians, when you dig into our data, you'll really start to see some differences in what those medians look like, what the market trends look like by specialty area, probably somewhat being driven by some of the increased emphasis on production and production-based plans. So I'm really excited to dig into this with you all. We are having a webinar probably around February that will be dedicated to advanced practice provider compensation models, model design and trends, and we are doing a deep dive into our data to look at differences in production and compensation based on things like, you know, those paid on production and really trying to dig a little deeper than we had in the past. So with that, we'll flip ahead a couple of slides and get into the hospital-based specialty scan. I know we've got about 15 minutes left with you all, so I'll try to keep it brief and hit on some of the high points. This first slide is really just intended to highlight, as we think about hospital-based medicine and compensation plans, these are some guiding principles we're regularly kind of working with our clients on and want you all to be thinking about as you think about the future of your hospital-based specialty plan. So number one, align with industry practices. You know, as organizations continue to evaluate the structure of their hospital-based specialty plans, you know, how much should be in that base salary? What is the definition of a 1.0 clinical FTE? And, you know, those expectations of coverage and access, and again, the weighting of that base salary in the overall plan, and ensuring that you have market competitive levels of base to ensure that you can recruit and retain talent for that baseline coverage and access that you need to provide in these specialty areas. Looking at, you know, things like the emphasis on productivity, particularly individual productivity, we're definitely seeing kind of a de-emphasis on individual productivity in many of these hospital-based specialty plans, but it's not going away entirely in many organizations. And organizations are starting to probe questions about group-based productivity. And this is something I would say is a really kind of an area you need to work closely with your legal counsel. And, you know, I know that, you know, there's a lot of conversation about team-based care, but there's also a lot of, you know, there's a regulatory component and piece to group productivity plans that legal counsel needs to be, you know, involved in as organizations address that principle. You know, adding flexibility and rewards, how organizations are thinking about experience, credentials, administrative roles, and, you know, kind of layering those components into their hospital-based specialty plans. And the future staffing levels and needs. I mean, this is a big conversation, and Maria alluded to this earlier as we were talking about and seeing organizations reevaluating their definition of a 1.0 and actually seeing some downward pressure or downward movement in those definitions. And so how do they kind of maintain that kind of balance of kind of the staffing needs and the operational kind of coverage needs? And then the most important one I would say is really the value-based indicators. This is an area where there's just a lot of growth, a lot of conversation, and a lot of opportunity as the industry continues to look towards value-based care. How do you increase and improve these value-based indicators in your hospital-based compensation plans? So on the next slide, just a quick slide to show you, you know, this is anyone who's worked with ECG has probably seen this slide. It's what we kind of illustrate as the continuum of clinical compensation models, from the far left to a purely fixed plan, and to the far right, where you get into what we'll call more of a production or performance, you know, driven plan. Now, in years past, obviously, we didn't always have that value component, but on the far right, we are now starting to incorporate even that value component, with more and more organizations incorporating value-based incentives, quality incentives across the continuum of their specialty models. Most hospital-based compensation models are going to kind of fall in that middle, where there's going to be a pretty significant fixed component. Again, that base salary for the expected level of coverage and shifts and access provided by the hospital-based specialists. Where we see the variation is, again, this underlying principle and determination on how much to weight that fixed component, whether to incorporate a production component, and then how much to weight that value-based component. So as we get into the next couple of slides, there's a lot of text here. You'll get a copy of these slides, but on slide 28, again, just kind of illustrating a little more deeply that coverage-based model, where we really have a base salary and value component, where we're looking at what is the target level of compensation an organization needs to be, you know, provide to be competitive. And then what portion of that value-based component is really kind of attributed to a target level versus a stretch level. So providing opportunity to their hospital-based specialists for when they kind of exceed those target level expectations of value and kind of move into that stretch level, how they can earn above that target level expectation. On the next slide, you can see then, this is a slide, again, the hybrid, where you've still got a production component as a variable component that's additive to the base salary, typically structured as one where there's a work RVU threshold, and then when the hospital-based physicians exceed that work RVU threshold, they can earn in that production component. More and more, we are starting to see some organizations capping those work RVU, or trying to kind of, again, de-emphasize the work RVU component really trying, wanting to make room for, you know, additional, the value-based components, again, de-emphasize pure productivity in their plans and kind of have that more blended mixed approach. But again, in this instance, you can see there's still this idea where there could be some additional kind of value component for that stretch level performance. On the next slide, you know, as we talk about the expectations of coverage, one more slide. So on the next slide, you can see some sample incentive metrics. So I keep using the term value rather than quality, because the idea of these incentives is really broader than just traditional quality of care metrics. That's usually one of the components or categories of measurement. But organizations in hospital-based medicine and practices are fully looking beyond that. They are wanting to incorporate efficiency and operations metrics. They're wanting to incorporate citizenship and service metrics. So again, this kind of this value-based kind of opportunity is more broadly to allow for measurement across these different categories. And as you can imagine, there's, you know, different metrics, you know, depending on the hospital-based specialty, whether we're talking about hospitalist medicine here, critical care, anesthesia, et cetera. Organizations may have some, you know, kind of similar goals or categories of performance, but then they would have very much, you know, specialty specific driven goals and around quality of care and efficiency that are customized for those specialty areas. So as we get into to discuss a little bit more on the coverage expectations on the next slide, you know, the historical model, particularly for some of the hospital-based specialties, hospitalist medicine is a great example, was a 7-on, 7-off, you know, schedule, 182 12-hour shifts worked or 2184 hours. This is a, you know, a common conversation in the market today and sometimes tends to be more locally or regionally driven based on competitive factors. Organizations are talking more and more about kind of what that expectation is. We're starting to see some pressure downward, frankly, on the expectation. You know, organizations dealing with, you know, burnout, again, dealing with local market, you know, competition, you know, physicians more and more kind of requesting for, you know, PTO or consideration for that. So, but, you know, as you're thinking about your compensation plan, this is a really important part of that conversation. You know, under defining and, you know, those coverage expectations and what is a 1.0 and how that translates to the salary data. Always remembering that the salary data that's published in our survey and other surveys is typically that total cash compensation. So if your definitions of coverage are lower, you'll really need to think about, you know, your base salary on an hourly rate basis and defining those expectations. Shift differentials continue to be prevalent in the market. Again, organizations, as they think about those guiding principles, thinking about how they, you know, recognize for additional shifts, nocturnal shifts, whether they provide premiums. And a lot of that is really, again, dictated on the structure of the plan, you know, the emphasis, kind of the local market, and frankly, some of the staffing and coverage expectations. But it's still very typical in the market to provide, you know, premiums for nocturnist coverage, whether that's through, you know, dedicated nocturnists who have a higher base salary or a reduced expectation of shift coverage, flexible nocturnist model where you have a shift premium for just those nocturnist shifts. But there still are some models out there today that, you know, do incorporate the value of the nocturnist coverage in an equal share model as well. So on, as I mentioned on the next slide, you know, that downward pressure we're starting to see on some of the expectation of time. You know, on the far right, you know, that total time, you know, kind of what we would say is the upper end of the market for clinical expectations, particularly for hospitalists, you can see here is still about 2184. But we are starting to see in some markets and some clients, organizations looking at, you know, 1800 on the lower end as a definition of full time. And really starting to try to also balance, you know, what is in that time. So again, typically we would call this kind of the productive time, or, you know, largely made up of your patient, you know, patient facing time, but may also include some of that clinically related administrative time for, you know, charts and other kind of activities that are still clinically related. Again, this is something an organizations really have to look at and assess on a case by case basis. You know, balancing their need to be, you know, market competitive to recruit and retain, understanding kind of local market competition, but also balancing, you know, coverage and access needs. You know, as you can imagine, as organizations look at if they're reducing those clinical expectations as a 1.0, you know, that's going to put some pressure on your coverage models and your staffing plans as an organization. So on the next slide, you can see just some kind of macro trends in compensation design and production benchmarks around hospital-based specialties. Again, as we think about this changing clinical FTE definition, what we, you know, obviously would expect to see is, you know, maybe, you know, continued downward pressure in work reviews. This is also playing into potentially the change in compensation model design, where we're seeing a de-emphasis in some of those production incentives. So, you know, compensation continues to increase year over year, but you can see work reviews are decreasing slightly year over year. So, you know, again, this is just something organizations are going to need to be cognizant of, you know, within the given specialties, their comp plans, you know, just overall market competitiveness and financial affordability. This example is just for our hospitalist medicine benchmarks that you can see on the slide. But again, the trends in comp and productivity from 2020 to 2023, kind of showing that trend of every leg. So then just with the last few minutes, I want to get into some of the implications of the future split share billing changes. So again, these are on hold. So everything, you know, our discussion here today is anticipating that there still will be a decision by CMS at a point in time, not 2024, unless they change course in the final rule, but that there will be movement towards the definition of split share changes and the attribution of work reviews to the provider who does the substantive portion. So, you know, some key things organizations are looking at planning for, you know, number one, that work review attribution. You know, there's the potential for APPs to start to see more of the work review attribution if they are the ones spending more time with the patient as part of the patient visit. There would be obviously implication to professional collections under this change, particularly in Medicare collections. Obviously the practice operations would need to be looked at and addressed relative to staffing models and, you know, the care models and care delivery and potential implications of any changes there. And then, as mentioned, just the downstream effect on production and production-based compensation models. So those organizations, again, and predominantly the hospital-based specialties, if there is a production component, if there is that shifting of work review attribution, it could definitely implicate, you know, kind of changes to those models and to the compensation levels provided to the physicians. So a little bit more information here about some in-depth series we've been doing on split share changes and things organizations should be thinking about in these different areas and can be found on our website for more information. So as I mentioned on the next slide, kind of the last thing to be thinking about in the compensation design, if there is that shift in work reviews when and I suppose if the split share changes do go into effect, you know, that shift from physicians to APPs potentially in the work review values, you know, how should organizations be thinking about that? So some of our recommendations include, you know, number one, obviously you'll want to be working with your group to address the impact. So what is the impact to the care delivery? What is the impact to work reviews? And then what is the impact to our philosophy as an organization? You know, some potential compensation model considerations, particularly for physicians, if they do have a production-based component today, should be, you know, do you want to continue to de-emphasize work reviews as part of that plan? Maybe even shift away from production in the plan and really start to focus on that base salary and those value-based performance components within your hospital-based specialties and plans. There could be a further evolution of APP supervision stipends. Some would say maybe there would need to be an increase in APP supervision if those plans still include a production component, particularly to kind of recognize that time and effort of the supervision. Organizations that move towards a more, you know, salary and value-based plan would say, you know, maybe supervision stipends are no longer needed. That's part of the salary and the base expectation. And again, you know, as we get outside of the compensation plan, organizations will need to continue to assess, you know, the team roles, provide clear messaging to providers and the patients regarding that change in delivery of care. And then lastly, you know, as always, you know, looking at the regulatory piece and the compliance, ensuring fair market value is an important part of any assessment of compensation changes, the implications of the split share billing, and again, just making sure that your provider compensation plans are meeting, you know, your overall goals as an organization. both the regulatory compliance piece, as market competitiveness, as well as just alignment with key goals around performance and attribution of that performance. So with that, I'll turn it over to Angie, and we'll wrap up today's discussion.
Thank you so much, Aurora, as well as Maria, for your thoughts on key market trends. Please note that if you did ask a question, and we did have a handful of them, we will follow up with you after this session with an email. And then we'd also like to make you aware of ECG's extensive library of thought leadership. And please feel free to check out our brand new website at www.ecg.com to learn about these relevant and timely topics. One final reminder, we would greatly appreciate your taking a moment to complete the electronic survey upon exiting today's program. We will be making a $5 donation to Doctors Without Borders for each survey submitted. Thank you, everyone, and have a wonderful day.